module, Pedagogic Theories and Use of Technologies and Their Applications, we'll be talking about what is pedagogy, pedagogic theories, what are various schools of learning, and the technologies which are supporting these schools of learning. Now, what is pedagogy? Pedagogy is a discipline that deals with theory and practice of education. It concerns with knowledge and skills of teaching. Theory refers to an organized system of accepted knowledge that tries to explain about a phenomena. Pedagogical theories are the theories that postulate how things should be taught, how teaching should be done, and how one can brought to learn. The main components of various models of general pedagogical knowledge are pedagogical components and psychological components. The pedagogical components include knowledge of classroom management, knowledge of teaching methods. Knowledge of classroom management means knowledge of maximizing the quantity of instructional time, handling classroom events, teaching at a steady pace, maintaining clear direction in lessons. Knowledge of teaching methods include having a command of various teaching methods, knowing when and how to apply each method. Adjacent to these two components, the psychological components which need to be taken care of are knowledge of learning processes and knowledge of individual student characteristics. Knowledge of learning processes means supporting and fostering individual learning progress by having knowledge of various cognitive and motivational learning processes, for example, learning strategies, impact of prior knowledge, effects and quality characteristics of praise, rewards, etc. Knowledge of individual student characteristics, having knowledge of the sources of student cognitive, motivational, and emotional heterogeneity. The next pedagogical component is knowledge of classroom assessment. Knowledge of different forms and purposes of formative and summative assessments. Knowledge of how different frames of reference work, for example, frame of reference, social, individual, criterion-based, they impact the student's motivation. Next pedagogical component is structure. How the structuring of lessons, learning objectives, lesson process, and evaluation should be done. Next pedagogical component is adaptivity. How we should deal with the heterogeneous learning groups in the classroom. Then we come across the various philosophical schools of learning and the associated pedagogies. First school of learning is behaviorism. Behaviorism means that school of learning where the whole of the teaching is teacher-centered. The whole of the teaching is stimulus-response-based. Teacher-centered learning is evaluated with the help of performance, and the pedagogy is very much visible that it is the teacher who is teaching the whole class, who is collaborating with the whole class, and the whole class is responding to teacher only. The various examples of the pedagogies which are supporting behaviorism are lecturing, demonstration, direct or explicit instruction, rote learning, choral repetition, imitations, copying, master classes. Now you find that in behaviorism, it is all teacher who is working, who is directing, who is explaining, who is giving example, who is demonstrating, and who is repeating. The student is a passive listener with following the instructions of the teacher and responding to the stimulus provided by the teacher. The second school of learning is constructivism. Constructivism is a very prominent and pertinent school of learning of today's times because it gives child to learn at his own pace and at his own level. It helps the child to construct knowledge with respect to his own context. It is more learner-centered or child-centered learning, where competencies are flourishing. Competencies of the learners are flourishing. Here, the pedagogy is invisible pedagogy. The teacher is at the background. The teacher is a facilitator. The teacher is helping the students and is not directing. He is providing the environment and is not giving instructions. Various project works, various individual activities, the experiential learning, it comes in this under this school of learning. And the examples which we can quote is activity-based learning, the project-based learning, the field-based learning. The students, the learners, are learning at their own pace, at their own desktops. Constructivism is focusing on the construction of knowledge of individual learners. Then next school of thought is social constructivism. The social constructivism is the school of learning which works in social context. Here, the social component is the most important component. Here, teacher guides the learner. It is, of course, student learning, student-centered learning, but here, the social environment, the social relationship, the social context is important. The pedagogies which are related to social constructivism are small group learnings, peer group learnings, whole class interactive works, extended dialogues with individuals, higher order questioning, very important, higher order questioning, teacher modeling, showing problem solving, inquiry based, all these pedagogies are supporting social constructivism. Then is the liberationist democracy critical theory school of learning. This theory focuses on critical pedagogies. Critical pedagogies are the pedagogies which are responsible for helping us to learn about more about those learners, those who do not make the part of the mainstream. So critical pedagogies are including the learners from different backgrounds, from different regions, from different cultures, and this pedagogy is responsible for developing the inclusive settings, inclusive setups of the classrooms. Though we are focusing more on constructivism, but critical pedagogies are also important, as the challenges of these rapidly changing societies are because of social context, environmental context, and economic context. Not only this, the artificial intelligence is making our society more challengeful. Digitalization is making our society more inclusive. Environmental pollution and limitation of natural resources is demanding our society to be more collaborative, to be more critical. Major health issues are indicating the teachers that they should follow those paths of learning, those philosophical schools of learning which lead to the self-construction of knowledge and hence self-development. Individualistic, self-centered citizens are growing in our society. And the interesting part is that humans are social animals. They are known as social animals. And whereas the society is growing, individualistic, self-centered citizens. So we need to find out those theories, those critical pedagogies, those constructive pedagogies, those social constructive pedagogies, which are responsible for helping the individuals to be social individuals as well. These all factors are responsible for moving us towards sustainable development goals. These all challenges are asking the teachers to work in the classroom in such a manner, to follow those pedagogies in such a manner that all become the responsible citizens, make sustainable developmental societies to lead towards sustainable developmental goals. When you see this developing society, you find even all routine jobs are getting automated. The jobs automation is based on the genetics development, quantum dynamics, logic of codes. These three areas, fundamental knowledge areas, are making all the ordinary jobs the automated jobs. But still, there are works which machine cannot do, and you require skills, the ability to learn and adapt, applying empathy and life skills. Even medical analysis requires human beings. Machine cannot take up medical analysis. Logical research requires human learning, human skills. Machines cannot do the logical research. Hence, we have to see which school of learning takes care of both the factors, complete automation as well as the involvement of human beings, where without humans, the advancement cannot take place. Absence of empathy in machine makes it hard for machine to design products and processes that will maximize enjoyment and utility for humans. Designing skills will be utmost demand. So hence, you can find the constructivism is taking its role. That school of learning is taking its important role. Conversational analysts are working with designers to create conversational intelligence. Ability to communicate complex ideas is becoming a highly prized skill. And this skill can only be harnessed, can be developed through constructivist philosophy of learning. The behavioristic, cognitivist, constructivist, all these three schools of learning are working in collaboration with each other. Where we need the lower order skills to be developed, we need behaviorism. Where we need our thinking skills to be developed, we need cognitivism. And where our knowledge should develop through our past experiences, we need constructivism. When you talk of behaviorism, educational softwares are available which can help us in assessing the responses. When you talk of cognitivism, the memory games are there which can help us to understand the thinking processes. But when you talk of constructivism, you have got ample of techniques, the digital technologies available to help and support the constructivist learning. The past experiences and group collaborations through digital technologies lead to new knowledge construction, personal knowledge construction, contextual knowledge construction. Now, when you talk of constructivism, you need to have inquiry base. You need to have reflective base. You need to have collaborative skills, integrative skills, and critical pedagogy. So to have all these skills, you know, a teacher needs to be very, very effective in the classroom. He has to be techno-savvy as well. We are having 7 effective teaching strategies for classroom visualization: cooperative learning, inquiry-based instruction, differentiation, technology in classroom, behavior management, and nowadays professional development has become very, very important. You know why? Because every moment the world is changing. The morning information and knowledge becomes redundant in the evening. So professional development for teachers is must. And these developments are more catering to. These developments are actually done through web technologies. They are catering to our various needs in our environments. Now, what are these web technologies? Web technologies are the techniques using which we can access various resources on web. Web technologies relate to interface between web server and their client. This information includes markup languages, programming interfaces, and languages and standards for document identification and display. When you classify web technology, you know, we have got Web 1 technology, Web 2 technology, Web 3 technology. Web 1 technology, the characteristics of Web 1 technology, when you look at, you will find that it is more. There is stimulus, there is a response. There is one way interaction only. Web 1 technology is focusing more on companies, on information, on displaying. Their sites are not interactive. The way teacher gives information and students respond, there is no interaction, much of interaction. The students are passive listeners. Here also in Web 1 technology, the learners are passive assessors. They are assessing, they are noting, they are not interacting. Now, when we talk of schools of learning, Web 1 technology is the oldest traditional technology nowadays. We have got Web 2 technology, which is very popular. Web 2 technology, it goes with cognitivism as well as constructivism. It supports these schools, two schools of learning. Web 2 technology, it's a writable phrase of World Wide Web with interactive data. Web 2 facilitates interaction between web users and sites. So it allows users to interact more freely with each other. Main focus of Web 2 technology is on community. It encourages, look here viewers, this is very important. Web 2 technology encourages participation, collaboration, and information sharing. So you realize that how the collaborative skills, communicative skills, team building skills are becoming important here, and they are served, they are developed through Web 2 technologies. Web 2 technologies is supporting our two schools of learning. One is cognitivism, another is constructivism. Though it supports critical pedagogies as well. Now, we have got plenty of examples of Web 2 tools like YouTube, blogs, chats, email, e-learning, discussion forums, Skype, Facebook, Twitter, and all social networking sites. To develop higher mental abilities, look here learners, to develop higher mental abilities, it means HOTS, higher order thinking skills, like problem solving, reasoning, critical thinking, the Web 2 technology is a wonderful tool, is excellent tool. Discussion forums, where discussion can take place, where interaction takes place, where your questions can be answered, where you can make a group and then undertake a group knowledge construction. Video conferencing, all these, they require collaboration skills. And while assigning project to group of students, the students, they come together, work together and develop a common fund of knowledge. And they may do it through working on Google Docs. So you find learners that how the technologies are supporting our schools of learning, how behaviorism is supported by Web 1 technology, how the cognitivism, critical pedagogy and social constructivism is supported by Web 2 technology. So these schools of learning can only work effectively in this digital world if we take into or if we integrate digital tools to in our classroom teaching learning process. Okay learners, let us explore and learn more about the Google apps which we can use for our education, our teaching learning process. Now the Google apps include Gmail, where you can take up mail, you can interact with your fellow beings through mail. Google Drives allow you to store files and create Google Docs. Google Docs, they create cloud-based text documents, spreadsheets, presentation drawings, and forms to gather data. There are so many other apps on Google Apps available. Let us understand how Google Docs can be used. How to use Google Docs? Google Docs is an online word processor that lets you create and format documents and work with other people. The step one is create a document to create a new document. On your computer, open the Docs home screen at docs.google.com. In the top left under start a new document, click new. You can also create new documents from the URL address docs.google.com/create. Google Docs step 2. Edit and format to edit a document. On your computer, open a document in Google Docs. To select a word, double-click it or use your cursor to select the text you want to change. Start editing. To undo or redo an action, at the top, click Undo or Redo. You can add and edit text, paragraphs, spacing, and more in a document. Step 3, very important step. Share, work with others, which you can share files and folders with people and choose whether, see another feature given to you, choose whether you can view, edit or comment on them. WhatsApp is another learning tool. It requires internet and smartphone to be used. Why do we want to use WhatsApp? What are those features which make it user-friendly? It is almost free. It is a new way to engage students in learning. It can be used anytime, and students' comments and questions can be answered and easily validated. It allows for the transcripts of the students' conversations that could be traced back for language analysis and progress. Another tool, interesting tool, my dear learners, you will love to have it, is the Facebook. I know you all are using it, but try to use it for your teaching learning process as well. It is one of the effective ways of interacting with the whole class group. You can share your class videos related to your course. You can create your own videos. Keep them short, interesting, and to the point. You know, the video on the Facebook should not be more than 2.5 minutes. Remember this. Otherwise, it will lose its essence and significance. Parents, you can even ask parents to join your classroom on the Facebook so that instead of coming to you for the PTAs, they can go through those Facebook and they can comment and interact with you. The practice will allow the parents to monitor what their kids are studying. When you assign a paper, they'll be able to see it as well at that very moment. At that very moment, the parents will also give a feedback to their child also and to you as well. So that will help, you know, it will become a more teamwork, interactive work, collaborative work. By involving them online, you will indirectly train them to work with their children offline as well. That will be a support to you, dear teachers. That will be a support, a good support to you, as it will help you to share your workload with the parents. This practice will force students to behave in the best possible manner, because when parents will be involved, the values will be taken care. The value laden, value integration will automatically come in that teaching learning process. Make it easy for students to get help. Students can interact with you and fellow students quickly and effectively. For example, after you post an assignment, some students might have got some questions. They will post their questions there. You and other students will be able to help them by replying to their queries. Use questions and polls to educate and get opinions. Using this feature will allow you to educate your students and receive their feedback. And this will also help to the students to interact with multiple thinkers, with multiple intelligences in a very effective way. For example, if you are teaching geography, you can ask your students to identify the place by posting a picture and providing various options, and other students can help to build that geographical place by telling about the flora and fauna of that place. Another tool is Presentation Tube. It is a service that teachers and students can use to record, share and watch presentation. You know, my dear learners, it is the best service to improve. You can reflect on your own and you can make yourself self-accountable. Your presentations will improve when you will reflect yourself. Presentation Tube provides a free desktop tool that you can use to record a video of yourself talking over and drawing on the slides. The presentation tube recorder automatically synchronizes your PowerPoint slides with your voice. What a beautiful feature it is having. The free recording tool allows you to record for up to 15 minutes, but I must tell you learners that your recording should not be more than 10 to 12 minutes. As the researchers have proved that we can only focus and concentrate for 12 minutes, and after that we start getting disturbance in our schemas. We have to keep this thing in our mind. Now I was telling you how to use presentation tube. Software to be used, presentation tube, and hardware requirements are desktop or your laptop, a webcam and a microphone or an earphone, and 5 to 10 minimum PowerPoint slides. I would say it should not be more than 10. And then planning for creating the video. Now what is the procedure? Step 1 is open presentationtube.com. Step 2 is select, sign up, fill in your username, your password and your email. Step 3, now sign in. Step 4, click download. Step 5, click download exe. Step 6, now install. Now these are the 6 steps to install presentation tube on your laptop or your desktop. Now by installing the software, you record the video in offline version, which needs to be uploaded online later. See, another very important feature that is giving you convenience. It is offline. So you can make a correction, reflect, and then finally you can upload. Now you can record any video using your laptop or desktop by pressing record button and press stop button at the end of the lesson. To see how video is recorded, press review. And while reviewing, you can reflect upon the content and your presentation style and your tone also, voice tone. And then you can revisit your video to review and then to re-record. Now these are the applications, tool applications for Web2 technologies. These Web2 technologies are helping us to interact across the cultures, across the ages, across the groups, across the knowledge foundations, across the various interactive groups available on the globe. Web3 technology. It is the executable phrase of World Wide Web. With dynamic applications, interactive services, and machine-to-machine interaction, Web3 technology is a semantic web which refers to the future. In Web3 technology, computers can interpret information like humans and intelligently generate and distribute useful content tailored to the needs of users. This Web3 technology is coming up technology. It will help the teacher to completely have a computer-managed classroom learning. The example of Web3 technology is TiVo, a digital video recorder. Its recording program can search the web and read what it finds to you based on your preferences. In Web3 technology, semantic web is used to convert the knowledge into database. The main focus of Web3 technology is on individual. Example of Web3 technology is semantic blog. So viewers, you find that you must have the knowledge of various pedagogies. You must have the understanding of various schools of learning, the philosophical schools of learning, their important features, their important components, and then not only this, you must have the knowledge of various digital tools which you can articulate, manipulate and use in your teaching learning process. And you must specify, before you take up your teaching learning lessons, you must specify which school of learning principles you are following and what type of technology can help the principles to be used, to be to be used for the teaching learning process in your classroom. Thank you. Have a good day.